Hello.
Hey.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Nod, a mindful motorcycle podcast. I'm Ben Bowers, as you two know, and I'm joined by you two, who are Anthony Partridge.
That'd be me.
And Charley Boorman.
Hello.
Father to two girls.
Mm.
Dune and Kinvara. And husband to the unbelievably patient Olivia.
Punching.
That's fair to say.
It's true.
Just secure the invite for dinner next time. Charlie's an actor, presenter, author, and adventurer, well known within the biking world. Son of Sir John Boorman, recently knighted film director. Mm-hmm. Must be very proud about that.
Super proud.
Yeah, it's very cool. Very cool. Charlie made an early acting debut in Deliverance as the pig.
I wasn't.
We'll come back to that. He made an international name for himself alongside his good friend Ewan McGregor on the Long Way Round TV documentary. And since then, he has not only gone on to complete two more long ways, but has featured in numerous adventure travel shows, including By Any Means, Race to Dakar, Right to the Edge, World's Most Dangerous Roads, Extreme Frontiers, and Charley Boorman's USA Adventure. A successfully published author, Charley has penned seven books, including his 2017 autobiography, Long Way Back. All this despite having dyslexia.
Mm-hmm.
The books here?
Some of them, yeah.
They are ghostwritten.
Yeah, of course
they are. Yeah.
I mean, I'm completely dyslexic.
It's not all been plain sailing for Charley. However, he lost his sister, Telsha, in 97, age 37. Mm. Got the facts right there. Beat testicular cancer himself in his 40s. And has recovered from two near-fatal motorcycle crashes in the last 8 years. Despite all this, Charlie's bounce-back ability, quite like that one, this describes you pretty well, bounce-back ability,
like
I think.
Basketball player.
He's bouncing less, I see, though.
Is
less bouncing these days.
Yeah, but yeah, he doesn't bounce as much as he used to.
More snappy.
But he's back.
I'm more thud. I think the older you get.
Crack.
The last line, we didn't quite get to there. Yeah, his bounce-back ability is remarkable and continues to inspire. So I said some nice things about
you. Did
you
say some nice things,
because,
yeah.
Well, I believe them.
Oh, that's so kind of you.
Hope you say nice things about me.
Well, yours is a lot shorter than mine.
I got a feeling there's not going to be very nice things said about me.
Most of the stuff I've got of you was off Wikipedia, so it's probably not true. Charley.
My net worth is not a million pounds.
It's not a million
pounds.
I know, but that's not what the internet tells me. Anthony Susan Partridge. I've made that bit up. That's not...
That's my mum's name now.
Oh,
it's a good guess.
Oh, yeah.
It's good. She'll be here.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Oh, I've got to drive 5.5 hours to pick her up from the airport.
Well, she'd be pleased she got a mention in the first episode.
Yeah.
Hello, Anthony's mum, Susan.
Hi, Susan. She can be on the podcast if she wants. She'll be here.
Well, let's
I think
discuss
one
that offline.
Partridge is enough, I think, to be honest.
According to Google, Ant is an actor. It's true. Says you're an actor.
I am.
He was born in 1886, is 5'7", has green eyes, brown hair, and has a net worth of $1 million. All we know is his business card has one word on it, which we won't repeat.
Begins with a C and ends in a...
Next Tuesday.
Yeah.
He is a world-renowned custom motorcycle builder. Again, none of this is true. Host of hit Discovery TV series Goblin Works. Half Canadian, half British, with family both sides of the pond. Ant has a daughter, Maddie, arguably more talented in fabrication than her dad, and two dogs he lives with alongside his girlfriend and co-presenter, Helen Stanley.
Mm.
He's had his fair share of challenges in life, both personally and professionally, and is never far away from the next drama. Ant is to drama what is to flies.
I thought we weren't swearing on this podcast.
I think that's fine. I think it aptly communicates the point that you are a walking... Drama,
and don't forget that your business card was made up by your missus, wasn't it? She came up with that word and that card for you. Says quite a lot, really.
Through repetitive use,
yeah.
That card gets me a lot of business.
I'm sure it does. Yeah.
See that card. If I give that to you, your reaction to that card tells me whether I'm going to like you or not. And if you react badly to that card,
if
you look at that and you get offended by it, I don't want to hang out with you.
No, that's fair enough. But I remember looking at it and just thinking,
you were jealous. You were like, I
was slightly jealous. I wish I had a car like that. But at the same time, I was just thinking, it was like a totally normal card. It was like, yep, no, that makes total sense. I didn't even question it. I was a bit jealous of it, but I didn't question it. I just put it in my pocket and thought, well, that's right. Anyway.
Mind you, you're dyslexic, so you probably thought it said something completely different.
Yeah, probably.
Charley.
Yeah.
Let's get into biking. Yep. Now, we'll try and cover off some stuff that people haven't heard that's not in your autobiography and everything else.
One of my many books.
I think there was a post. Was there a post the other day? Or actually, embarrassingly, I've just started watching Long Way Round.
Oh, yeah.
Because I just love spending time with you, virtually or otherwise.
Well, you've only just watched Long Way Up.
That's so true. I have only just watched Long Way Up.
You've forced me to come onto this show and still haven't seen...
I thought I'd better do some research.
Well, you've seen it Long Way Round. That's all you've seen.
Yeah, but I watched Long Way Down as well. I've watched them all first time.
Yeah. Do you like my performance at the end?
It was fantastic.
My father, actually, he said to me, Charley, if you sit on that sofa with that bloke, I'll give you a tricycle. I mean, nowadays, that's totally inappropriate now. But
yeah, you have to declare earnings and stuff.
You have to
now.
Declare earnings. Yeah, but my father said, and I got paid a tricycle. And my father's mantra was whenever he was making movies, he made a whole ton of movies. And his mantra was always, you know, and when a kid came up in the script, he would go, no, don't pay for one.
I've got
four children who are free.
Amazing.
And so that was that.
So that tricycle, was that your first, your first wheels?
I suppose, so people often ask me, you know, how did you get into bikes and stuff? I mean, I suppose that's
one of those really boring entry questions, isn't it?
It is, yeah. But I suppose my father was obsessed by horse riding. And when we lived in Ireland, we lived in the middle of nowhere in Ireland, up in the Wicklow Mountains. And
you know, horse riding, scary.
And horses, yeah, we had horses. So I used to ride a lot. And then Tommy Rochard, this friend up the road, he had a Mako 400, which was just, you know, it's the bomb in those
awesome
days.
Bike.
Awesome bike. Still
awesome.
One of the most beautiful
when
looking
bikes.
When
you see bikes. A Mako. They're...
You know, with the cylinder heads, yeah, those
all
fins.
The fins.
Yeah, just, yeah. Oh, gorgeous bike. And I remember just hearing this, that two-stroke noise, you know, and it was a calling, wasn't it? You know, and so anyway, I went up and I convinced him to give me a go on that. And he gave me a go. I couldn't touch the foot pegs, but he sort of, in the field, he just pushed me off and I just rode around in first gear until I fell off. But and then I went back and I just thought, you know, I'm not going to ride horses there. You got to muck them out. Yeah. You got to feed them. You got to brush them down. You got to do, you know, clean all the tack. Whereas a motorbike, you just ride it all day long and then lean it against a wall and off you go. So
plus if you stand beside your motorcycle, it's not going to kill you.
No, a horse
if it turns around.
Could do.
It can kill you.
I still love riding
horses. You walk behind it and kick you in the face. Your motorcycle's not going to kick you in the face.
Well, I have to say, motorcycles, I've been closer to death on a motorcycle than I've ever been on a horse. So, and I used to
do
quite a lot of
skill level, you know, ambition.
Well, someone said to me once, if you're not crashing, you're not trying.
So you're a real trier.
Yeah, you're trying hard. Trying hard.
That didn't quite work out.
We all
really
are.
The context wasn't quite right. Yeah. Anyway, so no, but bikes. But my father, my grandfather rode a motorbike in the Second World War, but he was a messenger. But he, you know, he didn't have any passion for it. You know, he rode it during the Second World War. Then,
well, it was very dangerous work because of the messengers. See that quite often they'd be sort of near enemy lines, behind enemy lines, and quite vulnerable. And the Germans used to put wire across
Yeah, that's right.
The roads.
Yeah, thin wire.
Yeah, which used to decapitate the riders. And the Americans came up with this idea of raising the bars up. Yeah. And hence the ape hangers were created.
Oh, is
they,
that they
used
why?
To catch the wire.
Wow, you know, I never knew that.
So you should ride. You should be riding with ape hangers. To be fair,
I was riding with ape hangers.
They're
in LA
actually quite
a few years ago, and but these were really high.
Oh
ones.
Yeah, you can't get
and
too it was, over your shoulders.
I was riding with Ewan and I ended up at Orange County Choppers after Long Way Round, and we went out, and that's the funniest story. So anyway, we arrived there, and there were. They were so nice. They got this table and they got this map out of the world. And they were sitting there, we'd literally just finished going around the world. And they couldn't believe that what we'd done. They were there anyway. So they said, go and choose whatever bike you want, and we'll go for a ride. So I got this sort of ape hanger thing, and after about 10 minutes, you know, there's no feeling in your hands because the blood's drained and vibration, like, and there's no blood, and you're trying to grab the brake, and you know, there's no power in your hands. But you only goes, oh, this bike's beautiful, and I think this was one of the big builds that they'd done on TV, and it was quite a famous bike. Anyway, so he's just putting it back, and he puts it back, and he dinks the back mud guard onto the wall.
Oh, no.
And does this little dink chip. And he was, I mean, you know, there's nothing worse when you dink someone else's bike.
Yeah.
It's just awful. You know, you're trying to fix something, can you drop your spanner on the petrol tank or something? But, he was mortified about that. And they were going, no, don't worry about it. Anyway, but that was Ake Hammings. So there you go.
I've got one more motorcycle handlebar fact for you.
I actually almost decapitated myself in that exact same fashion. I wasn't on a bike. I was running.
Were you running as a motorcycle career in the Second World War?
I was running away from... I used to play basketball for my school, and we went and played against another team. So after the game, we won, and they all... And then we kind of gave them the fingers, stood up, and kind of beat them off a little bit. And then so they got angry, and so they chased us. So we all ran. There's only a few of us, and they had like 30 of them at this school because we were at their school. So we ran away and went through this car dealership. I thought I'd be sneaky, and I'd go under this like overhang and run through the parking lot of this car dealership. And it had clear... like wire hanging flags, but all the flags have been torn off of this one. So it's just like this clear plastic bit of kind of wire. And I ran full tilt at it and it caught me right in the mouth. Ooh. And it made me flip me. I did a double backflip and landed straight out, spark out, knocked out cold in the parking lot of this. I woke up to all the people, the kids were at bay because all the people from the car dealership had come out and thought I'd killed myself in the parking lot and they were going to get sued. But
impressive.
But yeah.
Wow. Impressive.
Good. What's your other handlebar? Or do you want to keep that one in your pocket?
No, let's get it. It's average. I don't know what the handlebar is called, but you know, the really close ones together.
Rabbit ears.
Yeah. So they, do you know how they came about?
No.
No, well, this is fascinating. And if you think about it.
Split lanes, something like that?
No.
Just, we're not in North America.
It was North America where they were invented, actually. Hell's Angels.
Splitting lanes.
So Hell's Angels.
Filtering.
Oh, filtering, yeah. That's filtering.
You don't split lanes.
Well, because here, you just kind of, there is no lanes. You just filter through
but
London
the, But the
traffic.
Truth of it is, well, I don't think people realize, but if you're not... with your motorcycle test, if you don't filter with confidence, you can be failed your driving test.
See, in most other countries, well, a lot of other countries, it's illegal to filter.
Illegal,
yeah. So, like in Canada,
California's fine.
California's fine.
Florida is not.
New York. I don't think you can filter. I don't think. No, I think it's illegal in New York as well. Yeah.
Crazy American
which is
rules.
Ridiculous in crazy busy cities like that. You should encourage filtering.
It always makes you laugh whenever.
Well, you might catch your high caliber, you know, automatic weapon on a wing mirror or something that you're carrying legally.
If you filter, back,
yeah. Like, so it makes sense.
It's so funny. You'd be sitting in LA and I'd be filtering along, and there'd be all these guys on these big muscle bikes and stuff like that, all sitting there in traffic.
Okay. Yeah, just too scared.
What are you doing?
Yeah.
Just, you
know, go.
And then, and then I got policeman pulled me over and said, "What are you doing?" Yeah. I said, "Well, what are you doing?" And he said, "Well, I know what I'm doing, but I don't know what you're doing."
You're going to prison, son. But
California.
Yeah, then I did the very posh English accent.
Yeah.
So back to my story.
Oh, yeah.
There's a police connection to it because it was they were invented by the Hells Angels. And when they used to break, if one of their mates got arrested and was in handcuffs, they break him out.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
So you can, and break him out and
they
bring
ride.
The bike. So
oh,
you can still ride your bike with your handcuffs on because they're so close together.
I heard that.
What I do want to talk about, Charley.
Me. Yeah. You want to talk about me
I'll
now?
We'll get to you in a minute.
Oh, God, come on.
We'll get to you in a minute.
It's embarrassing.
We've got loads of time. We'll get to all of you.
If you're not watching, he's trying to take my mic away.
Just move the mic away.
Look, it doesn't even want
broken.
It doesn't even want to.
God damn you, mother. Okay, go on.
Charley, I want to get into the health benefits of riding and in your experiences. I know, obviously, as the intro says, you've had a couple of sort of major accidents in the last 8 years that have taken a lot of time and toll on your body and recovery. And sort of having been sort of with you for that recovery and sort of around and seen how you coped and sort of the tough times you've been through. So, you know, you've, like I said, the bounce back ability and your drive to, considering what had happened to you on motorcycles, your drive to get back to riding and get back to riding as quickly as you possibly can might seem odd to some people, because, you know, those are the bikes are the things that have created, you know, the difficulties in that respect. You know, the accidents that you had were on bikes. Why do you think it is that you've been so driven to get back on two wheels? What is it about the bikes that, you know, that drives you to get back on them, even when they've created so much sort of challenge?
I was going to say the money, but the money. You know, it's always about the money.
Talk about the money, but money does help. But I don't know. I think it's funny, isn't it? If you these days you have to take your driving license to take a car to be able to drive around, especially if you live outside of a city, and so you almost, like in the States, you almost have to take your driving license. But you choose to take a motorcycle license, and I think it's a choice. And I think it's a bit like people who ride horses, are obsessed by riding horses and stuff. It somehow seems to be in them. I mean, my father didn't ride motorbikes. My grandfather did, but only because that's what he had to do. And on my mother's side, there was no motorbike. So I'm not quite sure why it appealed to me so much. But I think the more I ride motorbikes, the more I realize that it has a real kind of, there is an element of mindfulness there, riding motorbikes. You know, when you've had a bad day at the office, it's a great way to get back and forward from work, because you're riding to work, you're clearing your mind, you get ready for work, you go and do your work. Had a stressful day. You know, I spent 10 years painting and decorating and doing people's houses up, trying to sort of earn a living. And at the end of each day, I'd get back on my bike and ride home. And there were no distractions, no telephone, there's no radio, there's no sitting in traffic. And so by the time you get home and walk in the door, your mind is clear, and you've left that day's work behind you. So that is part of it. And plus the fact is, just really good fun and doing track days and, you know, doing enduro and motocross and all those kinds of things. It's an adrenaline thing. And I think humans need to have to scare yourselves once or twice a week. Yeah. Anyways, I think it's good. And Simon Pavey always said that. And who I did the Dakar rally with, and anyway, so I did that, and then I think when I broke my legs in 2016, I broke them really badly in Portugal. I was launching the new Tiger 1200.
You sure launched it.
Well, that's as I was lying there with my leg. I mean, there's a bit of bone. I like to romantically think that some little
there's a stray shrine
dog,
around it.
Stray dog came along and ate it.
Have a chew. Yeah.
So and then it was, and I woke up the next morning having had this massive operation. Both the legs were done quite badly. And one of them, my left leg, was just hanging off by the calf muscle, and all the bones had come out of the skin and stuff.
Nice.
And then I woke up and I'd broken my hand as well. And so I was lying there in this hospital bed with three limbs out, and I was feeling pretty sorry for myself. But I noticed that this guy, he'd had a motorcycle accident, and he was in quite a bad way. Much more than I was, and from that point on, I thought, you know what, this is actually not that bad, and so then I just kind of used the motorcycles as a goal. I was desperate to get back on the motorbike, and I used it as a goal to get better as quickly as possible, to be able to ride as soon as possible. And there was never a question that I wouldn't ride again.
No,
I remember the first time I got on the moped, my wife's moped, and I was going along, and I'm thinking, back on, I'd kind of snuck out, and I still had this massive cage around my leg.
Is that when you come and did the DGR?
Yeah, well, that was a bit later, but it was very close to that time. Yeah. And so I snuck out, and my daughter was in the house. She goes, "Where are you going?" So I'm just going to, Ollie said there was a flat tire. I'm just checking the tire. Anyway, I went off down the road on this thing with this huge cage around my leg. And I'm thinking, this is fantastic. And I was flying along and all these cars and everybody were just flying past me. And I'm thinking, my God, everyone's turned into a nutter. And then I looked down at my speedometer and I was doing about 10 miles an hour. And I was thinking, this is really fast. Anyway, I had to sort of adjust with my brain.
Yeah.
But anyway, that was it, back on the bike.
Yeah. And that sense of adventure, I guess that sense of freedom that bikes give and provide, do you think that came from childhood, from being, you know, in the middle of nowhere in Ireland and having to...
Yeah, I mean, a motorcycle was freedom. And, yeah. And you know, when I was a kid, I used to go with my mate Kaz, who lived on the other side of the river. And, you know, we used to put a petrol tank on the back of our bikes and we'd ride into the Wicklow Mountains until the fuel ran out. And then we'd pour petrol back in the petrol tank and ride home. And it was complete freedom and stuff. But it was where it really benefits is when, you know, when you start doing long journeys and stuff, and we live such busy, busy lives, all of us, you know, haven't got any time to do anything and cram it all in. And so from Ewan and I remember when we first did Long Way Round and we were riding along and had day after day of just sitting on a bike and riding, your mind wanders and stuff. And that's when I would think about my sister Talcha, who died of ovarian cancer. And because we just had a kid and everything was so busy and I was trying to keep afloat. I was struggling for work and all this kind of stuff. And so I never had proper time to grieve for my sister. And so when we were doing sort of Long Way Round and having these long days and stuff, your mind would wander and you'd think about all sorts of things. But I often thought about Talcha all the time. And I've always sort of had a feeling that she's sort of sitting on my shoulder. And she had a very funny laugh. And so this is called a cackle. And so whenever I get myself in trouble, I can hear her laughing at me. and very sweetly, when we did Long Way Up, we came around this corner in, I think we were in Argentina somewhere, and it'd been raining really badly, and came around this corner and there was this double rainbow. It was stunning on this lake, just incredible. And Ewan came on the radio and he goes, he said, Charlie, look, it's your sister looking after us. And so it was nice.
Yeah, lovely.
She's always, when you lose a sibling or a parent, you know, you never really, I still have her telephone number on my phone. I can't seem to delete it.
Yeah,
it's strange that, and it's like I've my phone's like I've got the same, but anyone like friends or family that I've lost, and I've never deleted their numbers or their texts or their messages, or, you know, it's just I don't know, I don't think I could do it, you know.
No,
what I mean?
I can't.
You know
our friend Neil McNichol, who was one of the guys who invested money into the bike shed.
And wonderful human being.
One of the jackets at the bike shed is named after him. It's called
the gold top.
He used to come. Nichols. He used to hang out with us in Marbella.
He's such a nice man. And he would always, when I go skiing with him, when I used to, before my knees all got messed up, you know, he'd come down the slope and he was a fantastic skier. And you get to the bottom of the ski and he goes,
such a handsome
good Charlie boy. He said, you just fantastic skiing. And I go, oh, thank you very much. And then you go, and I would look at him, he'd go, and he'd be pointing at himself. And I'd go, oh, Neil, you were amazing. He goes, I was, wasn't I? I was absolutely. And he was just the funniest guy. I still have his number and text messages.
Yeah, I've still got his details on my phone as well.
What's that?
He's a funny guy.
I think in the world we live in today, it's so busy, it's really hectic. You know, life moves on so fast and at a pace, and it's can be difficult to find
time.
That time and space to process things that have happened to you, whether that's grief or illness or, you know, your mental health or stress at work or stress at home. You know, it's very hard to manage that these days. But being able to get on those two wheels and the wonderful, you know, say the freedom of two wheels to escape and go anywhere. You can leave your front door and you can ride around the world if you wanted to. You can just keep going and never stop. But it gives you that alone time and the space to really start to unpick this stuff.
And not only that, like, I think, you know, when you're riding along, you do have that time to reflect and you're kind of in your own headspace. But also, if you're, say in like when I lived in Marbella, I used to, if I had a really bad day, more or less every day, I'd do it. Not every day was a bad day, but every day I'd do this after work. I'd ride from, because you guys both know Marbella, Malaga.
Yeah.
The Ronda Road is quite a famous road. And my shop was right at the bottom of the Ronda Road. So I'd lock up the shop and I'd ride, you know, quite spiritedly up to the, about 40 miles up. There's a little coffee shop, a Venta, and you'd have a non-alcoholic beer, and then ride back down. But I'd go up there at pace, and you know, sometimes when you're riding along and you're just having a kind of a poodle, you can actually think. But it's also good, I think, when you're on a bike, if you're riding spiritedly, you know, you can only focus on what you're doing, the task at hand.
It's pure mindfulness, being present in the moment.
And that used to help me get rid of my stress. If I ride fast and ride, you know, on the limit for, you know, riding on a road, and, you know, you'd be overtaking cars and on, especially on Ronda Road, it's quite, you know, every corner is a blind corner. So you don't know what's around it. And it used to get up there and literally I'd come back down. It was about 25 minutes up and about 25 minutes down, and I'd come home and I'd go home and I'd literally be shagged. Like I've done, you know, 30 laps at a track just by, you know, just riding, you know, spiritedly and just coming down and just getting rid of all that stress in your head. It's just, it's a great way to
I've understood the same, commuting into London for years and years, into central London, just during rush hour.
You can't be thinking of other stuff while you're driving around.
There's nothing else
going
on other than pure survival and focused on what's happening around you, being in that moment and fully present.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's, you know, if that's a really great tool, both to decompress and, you know, clear everything out, like you said, on the commute home is wonderful. But it also means that you're kind of learning these skills, these important skills on being present and
you kind of have a radar, don't you?
Yeah.
I mean, you're looking at everything. Everybody's going to kill you. So you've got to
Preempt everything. You've got to consider, other people. And these are all skills that you can apply through the whole of your life, aren't they? You know, that time to stop and reflect, have that time out, but also the importance of just being, you know, conscious of what's going on around you, the people around you, what they're saying, how they're acting, their movements, you know, the anticipation of danger. These are all, if you take your time and actually unpick it from a biking point of view, these are all really important skills to, you know, to be there for other people and pick up on these, you know,
on things
changes
that
or concerns.
Most people don't pick up on.
Yeah, just that perception can really be a powerful tool to then go and approach somebody or help them and, you know, see if something's, you know, if you're acting a bit weird or not, you know, even if someone's riding a bit more recklessly than they normally would do, then these can all be prompts to say, hey, are you okay? What's going on?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, something happening because you're not yourself.
Yeah, that's how Ant rides anyway.
Yeah, but it's the changes in these out of control. Yeah, you know.
says the man who snapped himself in half about 200 times.
That was never my fault.
I mean, bear in mind, Charley, the first time we went out,
ride. Did they say?
Kettle. Yeah.
Remember the first time we went out for a ride, the first proper ride after you got back on two wheels.
Going down to Roy's place.
Yeah, and by the time, it wasn't even that. I was struggling to keep up with you to get out onto the A3 out of Barnes because you'd just taken off like a scolded cat. And like your first time back on two wheels properly and you're just gone. I was like, you're not slowed down at all then. And then you nearly got wiped out again in the Surrey Hills.
Well, that was because, anyway. But,
you didn't and it was fine.
We didn't and it was fine. But next question.
I tell you what though, our ride, what was it, 2 weeks ago, last weekend?
Down to the Motorcycle News live London show.
I quite enjoyed that.
Because you were quite slow. I was quite surprised.
Yeah, and you were on my 1260S Ducati.
Oh, yeah,
I was riding
tire.
A 650
I had a flat
Enfield.
Had a flat front tire.
It was quite flat.
It was like riding a chopper. I was like, we go around corners and he's like hanging off a corner. I'm like, I'll do that. And
I was on an Enfield 650.
He hangs off the bike, but the bike usually stays quite upright.
Yeah. But the thing is, you can't really cane your mate's bike. So
I was just joking. I think it was
really fun, right? What I was getting at was I haven't ridden with a group of mates for, I can't remember the last time. I think last time I was in Spain. So it was really nice to get back out. And you know, we weren't speeding or do anything crazy, but
we made progress through London. Exactly, on a Friday afternoon.
You can't ride fast.
No, you can't.
No, exactly. But
you can't ride fast almost anywhere.
But it feels like you're riding fast in London because everyone else is stopped still in cars and you're actually moving. So anything.
There's a lot of you know, that's the one thing you have to really be careful of when you ride in London. And I'm sure anybody who rides a motorbike in London will say the same thing. Is you know, as you're starting to ride every day, you get through the traffic a little bit easier. Mm. You know, each day you're riding, and then you stop being precious about wing mirrors, but there is an element of relying on the fact that other people are going to do what they're going to do.
And that's
when it becomes a little dangerous because you've got to, you know, as my mother always said, as long as you can remember that everybody else on the road's an asshole. Then you'll be fine.
Expect people to do the unexpected and you'll stand a chance.
Well, that's how I've always kind of, I don't know why.
Defensively.
I've always ridden a motorcycle like that. No matter, even if I'm going down the motorway. And I've always looked, you know, look as far forward as you, and look, scan every car, truck, and you think, what are the worst things that everybody can do? Okay, that car is going to slam the brakes on. That car is going to change lanes and cut me off. That car is going to stop and hang a left. You know what I mean? Just all the worst case scenarios. And I've done that with everything I do. I'm like when I'm using a machine or something, I picture like my hand going into the bandsaw or into the lathe.
Yeah.
And I just have these vivid imaginations of all the worst possible scenarios. And I think that kind of keeps me safe. You know what I mean? Because I know I don't want that to happen. You know what I mean? And kind of mentally, kind of subconsciously.
I think all these skills you learn as a rider as well. You know, the things that, I'm sure I'm not alone in this, but the things I look at when I'm riding a bike is, you know, you're looking at the wing mirrors of cars, you're looking at the rear view mirrors, you're looking at the drivers of the car, you're not looking at the cars, you're looking at the drivers, because they will give telltale signs with their movements of what they're doing, you know, to see if they're on a phone or if they start to glance, you can feel when, you can see people's body language in cars when they're about to do something. So you can read that rather than just waiting for a car to move.
Funny you say that, because I never used to look at the driver in the car. And I only started doing that. Jessie Combs was. She's good. Last time I rode with her, we were in Los Angeles a year before she died. And I was riding with her and she always knew where the hell I was. And I was like, how? Because I was like behind her and I figured like she was looking, she didn't look behind her. And I was like, how did she know I was going to move that way or that way? And she obviously raced cars and raced, you know, bikes and everything else. But, and I asked her, I'm like, how the hell did you know where I was going to be? She like, because I was looking at your eyes in my mirror and your eyes would go left. So I knew you were going to go left. So I'd give you space that, and I was like, wow, that's, and so I, so after that, I started then now when I'm riding, I'm always looking in people's wing mirrors and trying to look at people's faces,
looking through cars.
And you can see if you're looking at through the back of a car, you can see if a person is looking left or right, see that they're about to do something.
Yeah.
Mind you, none of that helped me in Portugal. but you know, it's one of those things, isn't it? But it's fun but you know, it's
dangerous,
difficult
as well.
It can be very difficult once you've had a big trauma in your life, it can be very difficult to move forward. And you know, sometimes I think I was very lucky. I saw that was a crash and that there's nothing I could do about it. It was just, you know, you can't, the what ifs and buts and maybes and could have, should have, you know, that doesn't help because you're just lying in hospital anyway. But you know, some people do allow a trauma to you get stuck there or let that trauma define you. And
that doesn't have to be physical trauma.
No, it doesn't have to be physical trauma. It can be any trauma. And that's where you got to really realize that you know, these traumas, that this is something that's happened, there's nothing you can do about it, you can't change it, so just, you know, put it, don't forget about it, just leave it
leave it where it was and move on.
Well, it's funny. I had a little off about 8 months ago.
Oh,
we all
was
know
that
about.
On a
no?
On
don't.
A
don't
thing.
I've been told. I've signed an NDA.
I haven't, and I was there.
It's your fault. It's your fault.
It's
really
my fault.
anyways,
said, don't but, do. Oh, oh well.
But. I was just a little break. Well, at the time, I thought it was just a sprain, but it turned out to be quite serious. I shattered my knuckle. And it's literally been August 11th I did that. And I have that was the second time I was on a bike when I was with you guys. And I only started work about a month ago. I can actually work with my hand.
It'll be with you. It'll be with you for the rest of your life.
And it's still, because I had the first surgery. And after that, I was a bit down on myself. I'm like, you know, this is going to affect a lot of things. You don't realize at the time, shit, now I can't work. Now I can't do this. And I use my hands for a lot of things. I would have rather broke my leg or my neck or something. You know what I mean?
The neck. I don't think, no,
but then, you know, you kind of go through it and you're just thinking, okay, it wasn't even a bad, you know, incident. You know, it's just silly that I was only going about 10
Tried two
10,
broken legs, you know?
Yeah, well, exactly.
I'm just saying, I could, fucking finger.
I couldn't imagine that. And I'm just thinking, because I've never really injured myself on a bike. I've broke my shoulder and I broke that. So they're quite mild injuries. But that was, it took me 8 months of two surgeries to get
but
back.
But for the rest of your life, you'll...
Yeah, I can feel that, like now, like it clicks every time I move and it's stiff and it's sore and the cold. And
especially when the weather changes. My mother always had a terrible back, and she would always say, oh, it's the weather's changing. And she was always right, but she could...
You can feel it. Well,
I can feel it now as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, I wake up in the morning sometimes and it's like, oof. But, you know, these, for my injuries these days, I still go to bed now. You know, this is from 2016.
You're still in chronic pain, aren't you?
Yeah. And the last thing I think about when I go to sleep is my ankle.
Yeah.
And the first thing I wake up is think about my ankle.
The great thing about both of you, you know, through those periods where you've been struggling is you've spoken about it, and you've spoken about how you're feeling and the fact that you're down and you're struggling. You know, you were, and we spoke a number of times. You were really, I was worried about you, but you were talking. I was definitely
depressed.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I thought, shit, I can't earn any money. I can't work. I can't ride a motorcycle. Because what, you know,
all the things that make you happy.
The main two things I do in life is work and ride motorcycles. You know what I mean? And those are the two things I can't do right now. And it's just a silly, like everything else works. It's not like, you know what I mean? It's just, I can't use that hand. And I was, you know, I was quite depressed. I was thinking, I spoke to my dad. My dad's like, you know, maybe it's time to stop riding bikes. I'm like,
that's what everyone told me.
Not helpful.
That's never going to happen. That thought never did go through my head until, you know, after that. And that just kind of resonated with him. I'm like, okay, well, maybe I'm never going to give up riding bikes, but maybe I'll stop trying to race motorcycles. Maybe I'm a bit old. I'm like, and then, you know, it kind of comes back and that all goes out the window. You're like, forget that. When are we signing up for the next race? You know?
Yeah. I think I've definitely changed slightly my riding now.
You get a bit more cautious and you kind of...
A little bit more cautious now. And don't give me that. I have to say that. I promised my wife that I would take it more seriously.
Okay, I was going to say, you're either sponsors or your wife. I don't know who you're talking to right now.
Anyway, no, but you know, I think on the whole, I think we can all agree that you know, I think you've got to be very lucky. There's lots of people who have their whole working life and they finish work, and all they've done is work, and they've never had any outside.
Like hobbies, activities,
or passions, and I think and you look at people who you know stop work or move on at the weekends. You know, the ones who are really happy are the people who you know ride motorcycles, who ride horses,
who have a passion,
go out and play golf, who ride bicycles. It doesn't matter what it is, and what you're doing with golfing or biking or whatever it is, you're interacting with other people and you're sharing that passion with other people. So even if you're with a bunch of guys who ride motorbikes or a bunch of people who ride motorbikes and you all sort of sit around together, if you haven't got that much in common, you just sit and talk about motorcycles.
Yeah.
And it's lovely. And to be able to, to carry on, you know, riding motorcycles. You know, I've got a friend who he rode into his, he came to Africa on one of my motorcycle tours, and he was 82 years old and he rode most of the Africa tour with us. And he was an amazing guy. He built all those Triumph engines for Matchless. You know, that's what he's there. He built all those beautiful engines. And so, you know, and how lovely is that to be able to have that passion?
Do
the rest of your life.
Do you guys remember? Do you remember John Giles at the Mallet Mile?
Yeah, I beat him.
Well,
I mean,
he's 88, so you know.
Well, I beat him.
But
well, he should beat somebody.
Literally, the only person.
Did you beat him with a baseball bat, or did you actually ride a motorcycle?
But, no, I beat him with a special Carl Fogarty launch scrambler Triumph T120, I think.
Yeah. And he was on a bike he'd built himself, and he'd just changed the clutch on the side of his van.
Yeah, yeah,
the side of his van.
He must
by
be 84 at that point. Yeah, and he still did half the sprint race on the back wheel.
Yeah, he did the whole sprint.
That was probably a mistake.
He needed help to get on the bike.
And then he got on
the back wheel and just did the whole sprint race on the back wheel at 88.
DNA. It's just
a legend of a man.
So I claim as I beat a man that used to beat Steve McQueen. So, you know, I've essentially, proxy, beaten Steve McQueen at bike racing.
Yeah, but if anybody wants to get a feeling for why people ride motorcycles and what people do, you know, that classic movie On Any Sunday is a really good example, because they're making a movie just about what people get up to on a motorbike on the weekend. It's a fantastic movie to explain why.
The second one's quite good as well.
The second one's quite good, yeah.
But on Any Monday.
On Any Monday, yeah. But the other film that people should see...
On Every Other Sunday.
On Every Other Sunday. But the other one that people should look at as well is Closer to the Edge, which is the Ullman TT one. And if you want to know why people ride motorcycles...
There's a new MotoGP from last season coming out. Interesting.
Those guys are bonkers nuts, though. You know what I mean? Like, if you've never ridden a motorcycle before and you go straight in to watch that movie, you'll probably
never ride
a motorcycle
but I think,
again.
I think John McGuinness has said that he'd love to come on the
absolute
and so we'll I think we'll
well.
We'll save that conversation for
for
McGuinness.
For the boys that have done it, absolutely.
I just want to put it out there that I've chased John McGuinness around the Ullman TT.
Oh, hold on. Chased is very strong.
I'm just going to leave
let's
that.
Let's say follow, like, follow
what are we
him.
Doing? What are we doing?
It's
next?
Been like saying you've done the Dakar, isn't it?
Yeah.
you got
your jacket. Yeah.
I don't see your race number.
I'm not sure how you can write a book with so many words in it for a man that's only done five stages of the race. You know, there's another 13 days. How big would the book have been if you'd actually finished it?
Thank you, everyone, for listening. Thank you, Anthony.
Thank you,
Charlie.
Thank you.
I've been Ben Bowers. This has been The Nod.